I love RTGs. They are amazing. They allow us to explore different corners of space, planets in our solar system, and also our own planet. They power dozens of satellites and space probes, including Voyager 1 and 2, and also the Curiosity rover on Mars. The best part about them, they can work for decades without refueling or any maintenance. I mean, this is the exact reason why they're used in space. Like, they don't even have moving parts. You just install them and they work. What makes me like them even more is that their design is fairly simple. I mean, okay, it still takes a lot of effort to produce them, and don't get me wrong. But this is not a fission reactor. This is still much easier. That's because they work on a simple principle, the Seebeck effect. If you heat one end of a thermocouple and cool the other one, it starts producing electricity. You can use practically anything as a heat source. For example, kerosene lamp-powered radios were quite common in the USSR. The kerosene lamp, which usually was hanging above the radio, was heating a thermocouple, which in turn produced electricity that powered the radio. RTGs, however, work on nuclear energy. As you know, during the decay of an isotope, it produces radiation. It emits alpha or beta particles and gamma rays. The kinetic energy of these emitted particles and the energy carried by gamma rays contribute to an increase in temperature in the material undergoing decay, as this energy is absorbed by the surrounding environment, leading to the generation of heat. What we do next is capture this heat with thermocouples, which then produce electricity through the Seebeck effect. Not every isotope can be used in RTGs, and there are certain criteria that an isotope needs to meet. The most important one is its half-life. If an isotope has a short half-life, it will quickly stop producing electricity. Remember that the whole point of RTGs is to produce energy for a long period without refueling, so isotopes with longer half-lives are preferred. A second important factor is how much heat an isotope produces. Not every isotope can produce enough heat. For example, gamma-emitting isotopes are less desirable because the conversion of photon energy to thermal energy is extremely inefficient. And the third factor is the size. If an isotope passes all the criteria above, but we need an inordinate amount of the substance to produce the required energy, it will be less attractive. Every gram and every centimeter matters on extraterrestrial vehicles, so we have to be really efficient. Plutonium-238 meets all the criteria, and that's why it's the most widely used isotope. As I said earlier, the primary use of RTGs is satellites and space probes. Here you can see an RTG on the Voyager, and here you can see it on the Curiosity rover on Mars. But RTGs are used on our planet too. Soviets use them to power various equipment in remote areas. Most notably, they use them for their lighthouses on the Arctic Circle. It seemed like a really smart idea, and I mean, it was. The places where they used them were super remote and isolated. They also lacked sun, so you couldn't use solar panels, for example. Everything was alright, until the USSR collapsed. If during the USSR their military regularly checked on them, there were routine maintenance and inspection procedures, but after the collapse, the new Russian government didn't have enough money for that, so they abandoned them. Which is not the smartest idea. You don't just abandon a device with a radioactive isotope inside. That's a disaster waiting to happen. And, well, the disaster happened. And not just once. These RTGs that the Soviets used on the ground were placed into regular metal cages, which became targets of metal scavengers. Some, however, didn't stop there. In the hope of finding valuable metals like copper, certain individuals were disassembling the shielding with the radioactive isotope itself. But the most infamous incident occurred in Georgia, Lia incident. You probably heard about this one. In short, three individuals went to the snowy mountains in the winter to gather firewood. But because it was getting late and there was a bunch of snow, they decided to stay there overnight. During the search for firewood, they found some kind of heat source that melted the snow within a 1 meter radius and where steam was coming from the ground, so they decided to set the camp there. This heat source, as you probably already guessed, was none other than an abandoned RTG. This individual spent the entire night near the RTG, sleeping literally right next to it. Well, what happened next is that they received serious injuries and one of them died. This incident attracted a lot of attention from the public, and Russians started to remove hundreds of their abandoned RTGs. However, although they removed a bunch of them, there are still a lot of unaccounted RTGs. Their fate is unknown to this day. But even considering these accidents, I still love RTGs. It's just that we should limit their use on Earth. But in space, they don't pose any threats to humans. And even if the rocket will blow up with the satellite on board that's powered by an RTG, the risks of disaster will be extremely low. Because the fuel is stored in high-strength blocks of graphite and surrounded by a layer of iridium metal. These graphite blocks are proven effective in preventing radiation contamination, as in the case of the famous failed Apollo 13 landing in 1970, when its RTG remained in the ocean after returning to Earth. But no plutonium contamination was detected. Thank you for watching. See you soon.